Welcome to week two in our series of video devotions for Lent, sponsored by the West Guilford Missional Network. I'm Veronita Alvord, and I serve at Moorhead Church. Today, I'm introducing some music by our Moorhead Messengers, who play for our contemporary worship service at 9 o'clock on Sunday mornings. We're online, of course, and not meeting in person, as many of us have gone virtual through the pandemic. I'm also introducing my colleague and friend, Leon Morrow. He's the pastor at Hickory Grove United Methodist Church, and I find in him a faithful friend. Hear these words from the book of the prophet Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 1, verses 16 through 17. Cease to do evil, learn to do good, search for justice, help the oppressed, plead for the orphan, plead for the widow. In preparation for Ash Wednesday 2 weeks ago, I read this brief statement related to prayer, almsgiving, and fasting, the three disciplines, the three spiritual disciplines we practice during Lent. The commentator suggested that observing these spiritual disciplines is a way to do justice. Through our discipline of prayer, we do justice to God. Through our discipline of fasting, we do justice to our bodies and the gift we've been given by living life in a body. When we give alms during the season of Lent and always, we attempt to do justice and to work justice on behalf of our neighbors. Keep that in mind as we continue on this Lenten journey. Hear this statement related to spring and Lent by Rudolph Peale. The Gospels that prepare for Lent indicate the springtime labor that must be done in the vineyard of the soul. The soul must be harrowed by penance and contrition in order that the divine seed of the Holy Lent may bring forth an abundant harvest. If you would, open your hands and take a deep breath and join me in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, I give you great thanks for the coming spring, for the small signs of daffodils, jonquils, for the budding green on the trees. God, we are so grateful for the gift of sunshine in the midst of rain. We pray that as we observe your creation, as we observe a holy Lent through fasting, prayer, and almsgiving, you might remind us that there is a divine seed that you are planting within us that will bloom and blossom through the resurrection of Christ and through our faithfulness as we strive to share the word of forgiveness with the world. It is in your name we all pray, and everybody said, Amen. Thank you.
for all of the churches in the Guilford West Missional Network, Collins Grove, Greensboro Korean, Guilford College, Hickory Grove, Moorhead, Muir's Chapel, Raleigh's Crossroads, Sandy Ridge, St. Timothy's, Zion Hill, and any others who join us, may God guide, bless, and protect you during this season of Lent. Please pray with me. Holy God, help me to preach your word and that only. Holy Spirit, move in the hearts of all who worship with us. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Amen. If you would like to take a moment and look up the verses for today that I will be reading in a couple of moments, it will be found in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. At one point in those verses, Paul explains that the power of the cross is very important. And he goes on to say that the Jews are offended and the Gentiles say it is all nonsense. At that time in history, the Jewish people thought that it was terrible and sad if someone died in a, with a heart attack, or if they fell off a ship and drowned. That was terrible. But if someone died by hanging anyway, such as on a cross, it was terrible. That God would not allow a decent person to die by hanging in any way. In fact, they felt that a person who died on a cross had been rejected even by God. And the Gentiles thought the power of the cross was nonsense. So there was a different cultural point of view at that time than we have at this time in history. Hold on to that idea as I read the verses I mentioned earlier. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. The message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction, but we who are being saved know it is the very power of God. As the scriptures say, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and discard the intelligence of the intelligent. So where does this leave the philosophers, the scholars, and the world's brilliant debaters? God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish. Since God in his wisdom saw to it that the world would never know him through human wisdom, he has used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. It is foolish to the Jews who ask for signs from heaven, and it is foolish to the Greeks who seek human wisdom. So when we preach that Christ was crucified, the Jews are offended and the Gentiles say it is all nonsense. But to those called by God to salvation, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. This foolish plan of God is wiser than the wisest of human plans. And God's weakness is stronger than the greatest of human strength. This is the word of God for us, the children of God. Corinth was one of the most immoral cities in the world at the time of Paul. Understand that there was an isthmus, a narrow stretch of land that had a harbor on one side and a harbor on the other. People could have, if they wanted to, take their ships and sail out into the deeper waters where there was great danger and take several days to come around to the other side, to the ports where they wanted to deliver their merchandise, but it was faster and much less expensive to bring their ship to the side of this one harbor, go across just a few miles, and reload the merchandise onto another ship so that it went to the places they wanted it to go. What that meant was that sailors would come, get off their ships, and stay for a day or two before their ship was loaded again to go back. They had some time on their hands. Because all of this merchandise was moved, a lot of money was made. Corinth was one of the wealthiest cities in the world at that time. So what you have is sailors hanging around with time on their hands, a lot of money, and people from all over the world gathered there. It was a place where sin abounded. And that is where the Holy Spirit had Paul establish the church at Corinth. Right there where all of the sin was going, where all of the problems were. And as you can imagine, some of the problems from the world around them, some of the sin, some of the difficulties, worked their way into the church. Does that kind of thing happen in modern times? Do the distractions and sins of the world around us come into the church? Are there any church members who argue with each other over different political positions? Are there church members who get caught up in the sins of the community? Do we sometimes fail to be the kind of people that we are called to be? How is our world similar to Corinth? Paul advised the people of Corinth, and I believe that through him the Holy Spirit is advising us in these verses. The message of the cross is foolish to those who are headed for destruction, but we who are being saved know it is the very power of God. As the scriptures say, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and discard the intelligence of the intelligent. Let's think about the power of the cross for just a few minutes. There's a woman one time, the story goes, who got out, who got in her car and tried to start it. And she got a clicking sound. The battery didn't work. Without doing anything else or checking further, she sent her son down to a store to buy a new battery. He brought the new battery, put the new battery in the car. She turned the ignition and had the same clicking sound. At this point, the mother called in a mechanic who knew what he was doing. The mechanic immediately recognized that the battery cables were corroded. The battery was strong. The engine would work, but the power from the battery could not get to the engine because the cables were corroded. What is the corrosion in our lives? The power of the cross is good. The engine of the church needs to respond. You can imagine a church that is filled with strife over various things. One Sunday school class wants to paint the building a certain way, and another group of people wants to paint it a different way. And they have arguments over that. They would rather argue than get along. The corrosion in our lives can keep the power of the Holy Spirit from coming into our churches. What about into our individual lives? Do we have corrosion of anger or hatred in our own personal lives? Are we upset with some relative or some friend? Are we corroded with jealousy? Do we want something that other people have which we don't have? Do they get an advantage somewhere in life that we don't get? Is that a kind of corrosion that keeps the Holy Spirit from working in our lives? During Lent, let us remove the corrosion from our churches and from our individual lives. Well, now, if we start to crank the car and have a good battery and the engine is working and the cables are free of corrosion, we can still have a problem if the cable is not tightly connected to the battery cables, to the battery post. If the battery post is there, but the cable is not connected tightly, the power will not get through. How do we stay tightly connected to the power of the cross? I believe that we need to pray. We need to pray earnestly. We need to pray deeply. We need to pray often. Prayer is connected. Another way that we stay connected to the power of the cross is by scripture reading. There's a terrible problem with scriptural illiteracy in our nation at this time. And I confess that when I was in my 50s, I was called to become a minister, and I went to seminary. And I went to seminary with the idea that I knew something about the Bible. I had taught Sunday school classes. But the very first lesson I learned in seminary was humility. I learned that I did not know as much about the Bible as I thought I did, that the Bible has an infinite amount of wisdom, and I needed to know more about it. We need to study the Bible. There is a never-ending lesson from the Bible. I believe we are held tightly to the power of the cross through various church activities. I long for the day when the pandemic is under control and we're able to sing our favorite hymns together, when we're able to attend Sunday school classes together, when we're able to collect food and do other things as a body, and we're able to share with each other and talk to each other. I think being involved in church is one way to stay tightly connected to the power of the cross. The church at Corinth was filled with sinners. There is evidence from the scriptures that those people in the church engaged in immoral behavior. There was conflict in the church. People did things that offended each other in that church. But they came together and worshiped Christ. I believe because they held tightly to the source of the power, because they were connected to the power of the cross, they were able to accomplish something for the purpose of the Holy Spirit in their community in spite of their weaknesses and problems. We can learn from them. hold on to this idea during Lent. The power of the cross is not to be taken lightly. Remember that Jesus Christ was able to heal the sick, to raise the dead. The power of the cross paves the way for eternal life. Let each of us, this year during Lent, work to remove the corrosion that interferes and to make sure that we tightly hold to the power of the cross. With that in mind, Father, help us to live our lives to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help us to give ourselves away to others, being kind to everyone we meet. Spirit, help us to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all we say and do. Amen.